I want to thank Pat and everybody here at the Baltimore County Historical Society for having us here today, and thank you all for taking part of your weekend to be with us today. Our presentation is entitled Moving Lansdowne's History into the Digital Age, a Lesson for All Communities. And how many of you had seen that before today? Any of you? Oh, okay, a couple. Good. I guess it appeared to you to be different from the usual promotion for a historical talk here or anywhere else. And if you thought it was different, then we're happy because we want to show people, really, that I think, especially, that for history to be relevant in the 21st century, it needs to be informative, accessible, and entertaining, at least at times. Today, we hope to show you how to achieve these goals. I did a talk last year entitled Lansdowne, the Lost Village. I believe that the history of my community has been overlooked. For example, the other local communities of Catonsville, Violetville, and Arbutus all have books about the history of their communities. Dan and I may be writing one about Lansdowne's history in the near future. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with Lansdowne, here are a few interesting historical notes. We are proud of the fact that we have the only church in America dedicated to the Grand Army of the Republic, and it's on the National Historical Register, which is the Lansdowne Christian Church. We also have three congregations that were founded in the 19th century, the St. Clement's Catholic Church and Our Savior Evangelical Lutheran Church, both founded in 1891, and the Lansdowne United Methodist Church, founded in 1894. We have the state's oldest VFW post, which was founded in 1920. Lansdowne's middle school was Baltimore County's first. And our volunteer fire department, founded in 1902, still goes out on calls from the same locations they've been at since their founding. We would like to also pay tribute to people who paved the way for the current Lansdowne History Project, notably Doris O. Marks, who wrote a memoir about the first 50 years of the history of Lansdowne in 1938, Harold Oliver, Robert Tolson, and Francis Bannon, who founded the Lansdowne Historical Society, which was in existence from 1978 to 2004. And also, there was a loose mimeographed history of Lansdowne, and those responsible were Janie and Howard Oliver, Sharon and Robert Smith, and Betty and Walter Smith. Also, Jake Miller built a replica of Lansdowne's old railroad station and organized a centennial celebration for the community. Without the dedication and efforts of these individuals, our current project would have been much harder to complete. The current history project was an idea of Dan's. He started a series of monthly gatherings at the Lansdowne Inn, where videos of local history were shown, and memoirs and memories, documents, photos were shared by the members of the community. I saw a flyer for one of these events, attended, and got involved, and as they say, the rest is history. Dan and I are starting a live streaming broadcast studio built in the heart of Lansdowne. It's actually his grandfather's old grocery store and community post office. The promotional video, which you just saw, was the first of the video productions released from the studio. We are called TV Free Baltimore, and we will have a variety of programs, but we will feature much local content, including a show called The Lansdowne Hour, where on a weekly basis, someone representing a Lansdowne organization will be interviewed. And the important thing is, as our videos and interviews about and with current events and people are completed, they become a part of recorded history. We hope to leave a legacy for future historians to follow and to show other communities how to best present their history in the digital age. And now, to present this concept in more detail, I will turn things over to my creative colleague and good friend, Dan Cosgrove.
How do you tell the history of a community? Here's one way, right? The old way, the printed word. But I'm personally interested in telling stories visually. We are in the midst of a digital revolution. I got to take my glasses off so I can read. in both film and broadcasting, making it easier than ever for anyone to capture and preserve history. Facebook groups provide target audiences for subject matters. The history of Lansdowne, I will admit, is somewhat obscure. However, there was a Facebook group entitled You Grew Up in Lansdowne, a cookie cut for this multimedia project and just sitting there waiting to be engaged. Also, you saw a picture of our YouTube channel. Securing the YouTube channel name Lansdowne, Maryland creates another path for anyone to easily discover the history of Lansdowne. And then finally, I created the webpage www.lansdownemdhistory.com, which comes up as the fourth item whenever you Google Lansdowne, Maryland history. So that's also very easily found. In short, we have a digital infrastructure which exists today, which was not there just 10 years ago, allowing anyone to capture, preserve, and distribute historical information easier than any other time. So when I started this project, I wanted to keep the history very authentic, and I define authentic as the history of the community as seen through the residents. So what I did was I searched for firsthand accounts as opposed to looking for newspaper articles and things from the media. I really wanted to get the story of the community from the residents. So, as part of that search, we interviewed some of the residents at the 2015 Lansdowne Fall Festival, and we're going to play that video for you now, and you can hear from them their memories about the community.
On the corner of 3rd Avenue for us. And is that Ballmer Farm?
Yeah.
Yeah, Washington. There was a lady there. Her name was Alwine Picker. She used to come up and help dig the graves to put the people in the graveyard.
Really?
Yep.
A lady grave digger?
Yep.
Mr. Grimshaw owned a barbershop on, I believe it was Elizabeth Avenue. And I went there because, being a kid, I was fascinated by all the clocks. I don't care what it was. Every clock was different. It had to be at least 200 of them on the wall.
Oh, yes. In the morning, the B&O Railroad stopped a train in Lansdowne, and all of the people who worked for the B&O rode the train into Baltimore and then walked up to the Camden Station.
Yeah. And then they went on to Mount Clair, at least in your father's
case. Mount Clair, where my father was.
Right.
I can remember a friend of mine, his classmate was up here at Lansdowne Elementary when they built Calvert Distillery. And he was held back a year from the school because he went down there when they were digging. And he found unbelievable Indian artifacts all through there.
Oh, wow.
It was a well-known area down in that section for that. Calvert Distillery, I mentioned to you before. Saturday mornings, you got up in the morning in the summer, and you smell Calvert Distillers. You didn't have to know that they were brewing down there. You could smell it.
Lansdowne was like a big family. Everybody cared for everybody's child. Nobody got into trouble. You knew somebody was watching you. In the winter, we went sledding, and it was the older people to the younger people, and they all went sledding together. Some of the boys played baseball. And football.
My mother and father did all the gardening. My mother did all our sewing, made all our clothes. You didn't go to the store and buy jelly. You went out and picked it off the vine. And if you wanted jelly, that's how you got it.
We used to walk out as a family and pick 5-gallon boxes of blackberries on all the farms around and the fields around through here. Mm-hmm. Some of our property, we had almost an acre of ground, so we'd have it plowed up every year. I can remember them bringing mules in, a mule team to turn it over.
I came here when I was 9 years old. Parents bought a house on Clyde Avenue. Great area. I love this area. Back then, you didn't lock doors. You didn't give anybody a mouth either, because the neighbor would smack you around if you did.
I remember when Clyde, when his first store, him and his two brothers, it was him, Clyde and Billy, and their father. Their first day at a store was about, say, 8 foot long, 6 foot wide. It looked like a snowball stand. And so fishing bamboo poles and old reel jobs, fish hooks, and we used to sell them. One of his kids get out there, catch some night crawlers after it rained and put them in a 2 gallon bucket, old scrub bucket, take them down and sell them to him a penny a piece when we were kids.
That's how they started out, right?
That's how it started out. And they, now they got that big gun shop down there.
Yeah.
Lansing was just, as a child, you went outside. Once you got your chores done, and you weren't expected back till supper. And it was no worry about it.
It was
no
safe.
Nothing. It was safe. And it was just a gorgeous area to come up in. It just...
Ron Whitehead was talking about Grimshaw's Barbershop. Grimshaw immigrated from Germany, and he had about 100 to 200 German clocks in his barbershop, and that drew all the kids in for the business. But his son, there's a very interesting story, and his son, George Grimshaw, who you're going to see later in the video, he was born in Germany and then came to the United States when he was probably about the age of 2. And then in World War II, he went and fought for Uncle Sam, and because he could speak German, he was captured by the Germans, and we think that he wasn't treated so well. I'll just leave it at that. But anyway, he died, and he died within a mile of where he was actually born in Germany. And he got a Purple Heart, and the Purple Heart ended up at the Lansdowne VFW, and they were cleaning up the VFW one day, and they had one of those, shuffle boards. And underneath the shuffle boards, there was a couple milk crates, and his Purple Heart was in the milk crate, and they were getting ready to go throw it out. And luckily, there was somebody in the VFW who said, wait a minute, I knew the Grimshaws. We can't throw this out. But they couldn't find anybody from the family, so they put it up on the wall, and they put a little area there just dedicated to him. But that's a very interesting story that, you know, he came here and then fought for Uncle Sam and died within a mile of where he was born in Germany.
Can I add something?
Yeah, go, of course.
One interviewed Dr. Merson, who you saw. She said that she felt, because of his facility with the German language, he was being used as a spy by the American Army, and he got caught, and that's why he was captured and killed.
Storso Marx wrote a piece called The Story of Lansdowne, dated August the 20th, 1938. It's about the first 50 years of Lansdowne. Now, when I started this project, I went to the Arbutus Library to dig through what they had, and there was only 3 copies of this, and they may be the only 3 copies that exist in the world. So, luckily, I found that. So I found this, and I basically looked at it as a script, which I had to find images and sound for. So what I did with this one was, it was written in 1938. There wasn't anybody in Lansdowne that had a camera back then in 1938. So I went on YouTube, and I found music and footage from 1938 that kind of matched the written word that Dorso Marx had provided. And then there was some things that I could find that I could put in here, but this is the video that I came up with what she had written in 1938.
The Story of Lansdowne by Doris O. Marx, August 20th, 1938. 1938 brings to an end the first half century of Lansdowne history. 50 years ago, 3 large farms covered the whole territory. The houses were scattered and little is known of the people who lived in them. In 1888, Mr. Samuel Crothers bought one of the farms and divided the ground into building lots. Mr. Habercorn, the first purchaser, bought lots at Hammonds Ferry Road and 2nd Avenue. Mr. Habercorn opened a saloon and amusement park near his home, and large crowds flocked here from the city on Sundays and holidays. People came from afar driving their families for a day of pleasure in the country. The fame of Lansdowne spread, and in 1892, the Baltimore and Ohio built a station here. Soon the trains were bringing large crowds to Habercorn's Park, and often they were forced to run special trains. St. Clement's Catholic Church was the first church organized in the community. In 1891, a beautiful building was erected, and Father Holden was the first priest called to officiate in the parish. Mr. C.W. Hall began to develop that section of Lansdowne known as Joshua, and also Hilltop, which lies south of 5th Avenue. He must have been a public-spirited individual who looked to the future when Lansdowne would be a thriving community. For in the next few years, he donated grounds for three Protestant churches and for the Firemen's Hall. In 1891, a Lutheran congregation was organized, and their first service was held in a storeroom. The next year, a small frame church was erected, and Reverend Conrad Goads was called to serve as the first pastor. A few years later, the Methodist Church began to hold services in the store, which still stands at Hammonds Ferry Road and Elizabeth Avenue. Sometime later, they built their house of worship on Baltimore and Laverne. This church became famous far and wide for their annual Sunday school picnics. On that day, special trains ran throughout the whole day to bring large crowds from the city to enjoy the festivities. Children in Lansdowne first began their education by trudging the long distance to school on Washington Road. As families continued to come here to make their homes, the need arose for a school, and the first classes were held temporarily in the large house where the Knights of Columbus have made their home in recent years. Miss Neely Welchlager was the first teacher, and she continued to teach there until the new school was completed. This building is still being used for the education of the young, as it was purchased only a few years ago for the use of the boys and girls of St. Clement's Church. Early in 1902, a group of prominent citizens met at Mr. Habercorn's home, and the Lansdowne Volunteer Fire Association was organized. Mr. Hall donated a lot, and a small engine house was erected later that same year. A number of active members donated time, money, and services to make the new organization a success. Many social activities of the fire company brought pleasure to all Lansdowne. Large sums of money were realized by holding oyster roast and bull roast. A gala parade was held every Thanksgiving Day, and annual picnics were held in May, and all Lansdowne residents were invited to participate. About the same time, a group of men organized the Lansdowne Improvement Association and began a long, bitter fight for improvements. They were being enjoyed by other communities throughout the county. It is interesting to note that the county commissioners began to promise walks for Hammonds Ferry Road 40 years ago, and those promises are no nearer fulfillment today. The chaos of the World War touched Lansdowne when 70 of their young men answered the call of their country in its time of need. As every other town and village in the land, so did Lansdowne also suffer, and pray and wait for the day when their loved ones would return. Three young men made the supreme sacrifice. The whole community welcomed back their heroes with a wonderful celebration in the Firemen's Hall, and residents of Lansdowne still talk of that glorious day. In 1919, a group of determined women began a vigorous fight for a new school. The crowded conditions in the old building had become so bad that even the portables were filled to overflowing. The Patrons Club demanded a large and modern school. They canvassed the town with petitions. They stormed the offices of the Board of Education until at last the officials were forced to pay them heed. In 1920, the cornerstone of the new building was laid, and all of Lansdowne rejoiced. No history of Lansdowne would be complete without a word of praise from Miss Mary Cullen, who served so long and faithfully as the beloved principal of the public school. In January 1920, Walter Howard Shaw Post, veteran of foreign wars, was organized and received its name for three Lansdowne men who had given their lives for their country. Those ex-servicemen, together with their ladies, auxiliary, have kept alive their memories of the World War and have helped to foster a true spirit of patriotism throughout the whole community. Lansdowne continued to grow and prosper. A hard-working, industrious people made their homes here. Houses sprang up everywhere. In 1925, the residents rejoiced. When city water was installed all throughout, they groaned and still continue to do so in 1938 at the heavy tax burden that was placed upon them for this convenience. In the spring of 1928, gas was brought to the village, and this proved a great step in its progress. In April 1929, the ground was broken for a new Lutheran church, and on December 1st, a beautiful house of worship was dedicated with impressive services. Dark days lay ahead for the people of Lansdowne. The Depression struck with full force, and many homes were made desolate. Life savings were lost overnight, and unemployment came without warning. many citizens were forced to earn a bare livelihood by accepting any work they could secure. Many could find no job at all and had to accept help wherever they might find it. One benefit, however, came at this time when Baltimore Avenue was selected as a federal project and over 60 Lansdowne men found employment in the improvements of the street. Slowly but surely, Lansdowne emerged from its dark despair and is gradually being restored to normal. The years of the Depression hit heavy on the volunteer fire department also. In 1937, it seemed there could be no alternative but to disband. Sufficient funds were lacking, and Lansdowne residents felt slight interest in the welfare of this organization. Public meetings were held, and through the advice of Mr. B.H. Shipley, the state president, a lady auxiliary was formed. This group of determined women went to work with a will, and soon the future looked bright again. All Lansdowne began to take an interest in the volunteer firemen, and today there are no finer organization in the community. Doris O. Marks, August 20th, 1938.
So do you guys think I did good with matching up the... a lot of that was from South Dakota. I don't know if you noticed, but on one of the winners said SD, but it was from 1930. I thought it matched well. But two things I want to talk about from that video. It talked about the new school, the first brick and mortar school in Lansdowne in 1920. Well, the residents, and if you go onto our YouTube channel, you can find a video about the cornerstone. What residents did in 1920 in Lansdowne, they created a time capsule and put it in the back of the cornerstone. And they, when the school was torn down in 87 to make way for a senior center, Jake Miller opened up the time capsule. Sun Paper did an article on it, and then they took all the artifacts down to the new element or the current elementary school that's still there, and they put a display in the lobby, in the front lobby. Well, at the time, the principal was Dr. Edna Mae Merson, who was a Lansdowne resident and who taught at the 1920 school. So the history was very relevant to her. So they had the display. Well, she moved on. A new principal came in, got rid of all the artifacts, and took the cornerstone and threw it behind the bushes out in front of the school. So when we started this project, we wanted to film the artifacts. We kept asking people, where are they? And we were hearing all kinds of stories about, oh, they took it down to a retirement home, or it's down there. Nobody really knew where it was. So we went up to the elementary school because they had their 50th anniversary, and they're also unveiling, giving a presentation about the new elementary school that's being built in Lansdowne. And I just was talking to some guy about the cornerstone. He goes, I know exactly where it's at. And I'm like, where? And he goes, right behind those bushes. And I'm like, what? No way. And I look, I'm like, oh my God, there it is, the cornerstone. So we talked to the principal of the school. He let us have the cornerstone. We made the video. We got some old photographs from the Sun Paper article so that history wouldn't die. But the actual artifacts are gone. Yeah.
In addition again,
here comes Jim.
One of the things the kids were at the school that year, the 1920 school, they all put, they're all signed in their names, and we do have the copies, if not the original, of the names.
And
they all put pennies in, two for each one.
Yeah, in 1920, the first class to graduate from the new brick and mortar school took a 1920 penny and put it in the time capsule. And I think there were 22 of them, I think. And when they opened the time capsule, and again, we want to tip our hat to those in Lansdowne that preserved the history. Howard Oliver, thank God, made copies, photocopies, Xerox copies of all those signatures. And for some reason, he gave the VFW a copy of all the signatures. So when we went up to the VFW to see what they had, the guy that's running the place, he said, oh, I went into the office of our auxiliary and I found this box, and we're looking through it, and we didn't know what they were at first. So, Howard Oliver did a good job when he was president of the Historical Society. So, and there was something else I wanted to touch on near the end of that video. I can't remember. Oh. The Lansdowne Volunteer Fire Department really did a great job in preserving their history. From 1902 up to about 1992, there was somebody in the fire department charged with recording their history. So you go into their offices and they have binders of their history. Unfortunately, they stopped in 1992. But the very first binder, well, when they started the thing, they were keeping their historical records in somebody's house, and the house burned down. So they lost a lot of stuff from 1902, I think, up to about 1920. But there is still a book. Somebody put some other stuff together from 1902 up to about 1920. But somebody stole that book. And somebody at the fire department a few years after the book went missing was at a flea market and saw it and grabbed it and said, "This is ours. I'm taking it back right now." So, you know, part of the thing that I wanted to do with this project was to digitize all that so that if a binder gets lost, a fire takes place. In fact, the last president of the Lansdowne Historical Society, who inherited a lot of Lansdowne historical stuff, his house burned down 2 years ago and he lost a lot of stuff. So part of the reason why a community should digitize its material so that in the event of fires and theft and all that kind of stuff, you don't lose it. And that's what we've done with this project. So anyway, back to the script. Where are we at? Audio history. One of the great finds that I found with working on this project was there was a gentleman named Leonard Marion Barr. He became somewhat of a famous portrait painter in Maryland. He did an audio recording in 1989 for his family about his life, and he passed away in 1990. Well, I got my hands on a copy of that audio tape, and in that, he reminisces about his childhood in Lansdowne. So we took those parts of the audio, and we made videos by it. So in this situation, I had literally, a firsthand account from the man himself and his words and his voice, and then I had to find images. So that was part of the challenge. So.
One quick interject there. He was also a professor at the Maryland Institute of Art for over 50 years.
And he lived on Lawyers Hill in Howard County.
Yeah, right. They moved, yes.
Right.
To Elkridge.
Right.
So now you get to hear his voice.
My grandmother was very nice, and she and my mother would take me sometimes to the Grand Army wives meeting, the veterans of the Civil War. It's hard to think that I'm that old that I could go to something like that. In fact, I can remember many years ago, the Civil War veterans used to come out to Lansdowne every year on a special train. And they would form in ranks on the road and march up to this Christian church and have service. And later they'd have a picnic in the grove outside the church. And I remember as a little tiny kid marching alongside of them, a very small kid. When I told my students at school that I'd march with Civil War veterans, they couldn't believe it, of course. They said, "Oh my God. I must be old," but such is the case, nevertheless. But finally, they all died off at once. First, the train came out with fewer coaches, then finally one coach, then a few came out in a bus and in private cars, and it was all over, just like that. But I look back on those days of what was called Grand Army Day, with a lot of good memories.
Do we have any photographers in here, other than you? Because one of the things I had to do was digitize photographs, but then put them together in a way that you could tell a story. So the next video I'm going to show you is World War II veterans. But when you get a photograph, a question arises about keeping it authentic. And I'm sure everybody down here has gone down the ocean. They've got that booth where you can have your photo taken like it's olden times, and they put that effect on it that makes it brown. What I had to do with a lot of photographs was to take that old-time look and try to make it color-corrected, so to speak. So I would color-correct the photographs, and then I would look at them and decide whether or not to crop them, trying to figure out if somebody took a photograph, what are they trying to draw your attention to? And so that was somewhat of a challenge. And basically what some rules that I came up with were, if I retouched, if I fixed, color corrected a photograph and then cropped it or reshaped it or whatever, if when I was done, if I had a different emotional reaction than from the first photograph, then I would just go back to the first photograph. So it was a lot of playing around and trying, questioning, you know, keep it authentic. You know, let's say, you know, should you as the viewer experience the photograph in the same way that I did when I first saw it? So that was a question running through my mind. So, but anyway, let me, and you can see what I've done. All these photographs in the next video were retouched. They were cleaned up. There were a lot of scratches and dents that were taken out, color corrected if they were colored. And but again, the majority of these photographs were taken by a Lansdowne resonant. What was Sarah O'Melia's husband's name? Jim O'Melia.
Jim O'Melia, yeah.
So Jim O'Melia had a little store in Lansdowne, and he would take pictures of all the guys that were going off to war in World War II. So.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Till then, my darling, please wait for me. Till then, no matter when it'll be, one day I know I'll be back again. Please wait till then. Our dreams will live though we are apart. Our love I know we'll keep in our hearts till then. When all the world will be free, please wait for me. Although there are oceans we must cross and mountains that we must climb, I know every gain must have a loss. So pray that our loss is nothing but time. Till then, let's dream of what there will be. Till then, we'll call on each memory. Till then, when I will hold you again, please wait till then.
Time in the town of Berlin when the Yanks go marching in.
I want to be their boy, spread some joy when they take old Berlin. There'll be a hot time in the town of Berlin when the Brooklyn boys begin. If they could join apart, tear it down, they'd take old Berlin. We're gonna start around, show them how we paint town down in Kokomo. Take a hike through Hitler's Reich, change the Heil to what you know, Joe. There'll be a hot time in the town of Berlin. Yanks go marching in. Well, you can never keep them happy down on the farm after they take Berlin. We're gonna start a row, show them how we paint the town down in Michigan. We're gonna take a hike through Hitler's Reich, change the Heil to give me some skin. There'll be a hot time in the town of Berlin. The Yanks go marching in. Well, you can never keep them happy down on the farm after they take Berlin.
We are interrupting our programs to bring you a news flash.
This is London calling. Here is a news flash. The German radio has just announced that Hitler is dead. I'll repeat that. The German radio has just announced that Hitler is dead.
Herman Thiele, when Jim and I were working on the project, Lansdowne has a very famous skate park. It's one of the, maybe the oldest in the country. And for many skateboarders, it's like Mecca. It's like you're not a serious skateboarder unless you go to Lansdowne and you skate in the skate park. So Jim had never been there. So we're talking about it. So I said, well, let me take you down and show you where it's at, because it's actually a path between houses to get back to it. So I take him back there, and it's pitch black. We can't see anything, but we can hear two guys skating. So these guys come out, and they're like 20 years old, and we talk to them. We're doing this history project about Lansdowne, and we want to interview somebody about the skate park, because the skate park should be celebrated. It's really a nice thing in the community. And the guy's like, yeah, okay. So we exchanged information, one of the young guys calls me a couple days later, and he goes, hey, you've got my grandfather in one of your videos, because the kid's last name was not Thiele. But his grandfather's Herman Thiele, and my family, the Ranke side of the family, has been in Lansdowne for four generations, but my last name's not Ranke. So as soon as I said, I'm a Ranke, he said, I'm a Thiele, okay. Then we both, you know, we know who we're dealing with now. And it's like, okay, we're part of the same gang here. But so that was interesting about
Dan, can I add?
Yeah, go ahead.
Again, since you've got Herman up here, thing was, when he came back from the war, he had a surprise, is they built the house for him, which is still there. And his son, who you saw a little earlier talking about the brothers who have the guns and fishing store, is Sonny Thiele. And we did a video on him because he was and is still Lansdowne's bird man. And he had all variety of birds in his backyard, from chickens to turkeys to pheasants to geese to you name it. And it's like, I guess it was grandfathered in. He's the only one in the community that's still allowed to keep...
to have farm animals.
Farm animals.
He's the last guy in Lansdowne to actually have farm animals. And the reason is because he lives in his father's house.
Right.
And he got grandfathered in.
Right. And he still has the chickens and gives my neighbor. And he claims he's going to still give me a dozen free eggs. But I haven't seen it yet.
The photographs, the way we got them, I had the book, so we knew they existed. We knew who took them. And again, tipping the hat to Howard Oliver, he got a copy of them. Now, the copies that he got, they were in bad shape. They were slides. Now, when he passed away, he gave all his... he was the president of the Lansdowne Historical Society. He gave a lot of that stuff to his daughter, Kathleen. He also gave some of the stuff to the person that came after him, which was Jake Miller. But when I started this project and discovered that Facebook page, You Grew Up in Lansdowne, Kathy Oliver started to chime in on that Facebook page and started to upload some of this stuff. And the people in there said, hey, one of the Rankies is doing a history about Lansdowne. You got to get this information to him. So she contacted me in a private email and ended up sending all that stuff, again, digitally to me, which were the original photographs that Jim Amelia had taken. So once I got them, I cleaned them up, put the video together. And now some of the photographs that are in there weren't in there. So when you go to the website, we list the World War II veterans, but it says these are the veterans not in the video that are listed. So does that answer your question?
Let me piggyback on it for you too, because I think you may touch it later, but since the young lady asked the question, part of the whole idea of the project being on video and website with photos is that it's organic, which means it's going to be constantly changing, added to, we'll be able to continue very much more easily than coming up with another edition of a book to incorporate any new knowledge, any new photos that we get. And I think that's the beauty of doing history this way. And also, with you talk about Alver, there was a Lansdowne History Museum in the basement of the Christian Church.
Hull Memorial, yeah.
At the Hull Memorial. But the thing was, that got disbanded and it went to Mr. Tolson's basement. And from that point, it got lost, and some people say some of it was auctioned off. So again, we lost another piece of our history that way.
Right. But also, part of our process that we used, the video that you saw is probably about the sixth edition of that video. What I did was I put an original video together, and once a month we had Lansdowne History Night at the Lansdowne Inn, and we invited people from the community to bring whatever they had and bring it in so that we could scan it and incorporate it. Now that one, there was a couple of gentlemen that I did not have photos for, and they're and they've passed away, but their wives sent me emails and say, you have to include my husband, and then they sent additional photographs. So the process was begin it, start throwing stuff out there, engage the audience, and this project is unusual in that I had to engage the audience before the project was done so that they could make a contribution. So at one point, we even passed out flyers in the community. The Sun paper did a write-up. Anything on social media related to Lansdowne, the schools and all, we got the word out to try to get people to go into that, into their closet and reach up into that shoebox we all have way in the back and family photos and bring them in. So, does that better answer your question? Okay. So next, what is next?
I got home from Europe full of hopes and desires and expectations just when the Great Depression hit. Unless you've lived through the Depression, it's hard to test to explain really what it was like. It was beyond all thought. I remember one man wanted to cut the grass and he fainted from hunger before he could even get started. One of the lowest spots I can remember is one time when I went or traveled all the way down in East Baltimore just to paint the prices on a meat store window for a piece of ham. That was it. We lived, of course, at Lansdowne, a railroad town, and every freight train would pass would be loaded with people out of work. The cars would just be piled high. There'd be hundreds of them on the train, and about 20 would drop off and looking for work, and about that many more would climb back on the train trying to go elsewhere. I had some ideas. I did a drawings for the 23rd Psalm. I thought I could perhaps get them published. I took them to a minister that I knew, and a Presbyterian minister, and he advised me to wait till after the Depression. Of course, as far as we were concerned, it would never be an end to it. I finally got together and took them to New York. When I got to New York, some people and published it, wouldn't even bother to talk to me. Others would say, gosh, a year ago we would have published this, we like it. But now we can't do anything. And so I came back and went to a very small publisher in Baltimore named Roebuck, and he printed in a small way on white and into a white little booklet, and we thought we could perhaps churches would buy it for people in grief and that sort of thing, you know, to give it around. And it was very, very nice little thing. We sold for only 50 cents. Whoever took it would get 35 cents for their part, and the publisher and I would split the 15 other cents between us. So it wasn't very much profit to it. My brother Morris, of course, was trying to open a small garage off the beaten track back on 281 Elizabeth Avenue. And, of course, the customers were few and far between. He did very fine work, and people brought their cars from distant places, even as far as Washington, but many of them could not pay him or didn't pay him, and, of course, what he charged was very, very little. So it was very, very difficult. My dad was out of work and had been dropped from the factory. And it was just an unthinkable condition.
My uncle, Marie Spahr, wrote a short article entitled "When Geese and Cows Roam the Lansdowne Streets." It was published in the Sunday Sun magazine, February 20th, 1966. We have a clip for you here.
Present-day realtors may find this hard to believe, but the photo above was used 64 years ago as a real estate advertisement. The community you see is Lansdowne, as it was in 1902. Specifically, it is Elizabeth Avenue, in the center of what Lansdowne old-timers remember as the Joshua section. C.W. Hall, who developed the section, named it for his son. The house in the foreground is the house where I live. I was born in it. The place was built in 1897 by Mr. Hall's builders for my father, Leonard Barr. I have no idea what he paid for it, nor what he paid for his lots, but an old plat I have tells me the prospective homeowners then were offered lots in this area for $10 down and $5 a month. Our house and its surroundings cover four lots. The house next door was built a year or so later by my father's brother, Centennial Barr, so named because he was born during the big centennial in Philadelphia. The white picket fence around the houses was there for a practical reason. Folks who lived in Lansdowne then were casual about the way they grazed their horses and cows. They just turned them loose. The fences kept the animals out of your yard and also kept out flocks of neighborhood geese, which were forever moving about foraging at will. Lansdowne in those days was what many people called a B&O town. Many residents worked for the B&O Railroad. And if there was what could be called a community center in the town, it was the Lansdowne Station on the B&O line. It was a pretty little wooden frame station, heated by egg stoves in the winter, with a waiting room for the ladies and a smoking room for the men. The railroad kept it decorated with beds of flowers that bloomed from early spring until late fall. People met there morning and evening as they rode the train into or out of Baltimore for a 5-cent fare. The picture above was taken from a high ore heap in a part of Lansdowne worked by the Whitaker Iron Company, which mined a great deal of ore in the vicinity. Digging out ore left many depressions, some of them quite deep, and as they were exhausted and abandoned, these pits collected water. As a result, there were several ponds and small lakes there, and they were fine for swimming, fishing, and ice skating. We called one Red Lake, because the red clay of the area colored it. There were also Pine Tree Lake and Third Lake. I can't remember anymore now, but as a boy we had names for all of them. Red Lake overflowed to feed that little stream you see in front of our house. It was a foot wide and a foot deep there, but got twice that big in other places. It wound its way over to empty into the Patapsco River. Many times, as boys, we saw fish swimming up that little stream. As a child, I put half a dozen baby ducks into the stream to watch them swim. I went inside to eat, and when I came back, the ducks were gone. I presume they found their way to the Patapsco. What you see in the picture was pretty typical of Lansdowne in the early days. The streets were red or blue clay, the houses were set well back from the streets, and in front of most of them were boardwalks. As an early suburb, we didn't have many of the refinements of the city. On the horizon, you can see a tree rising above the back of our house. There was a spring there at the base of a twin maple tree, and from it we once hauled our water for cooking, drinking, and general household use. I hauled much of it with a tub on a wagon in the summer, on a sled in the winter. Later, my father installed a 1,000-gallon cistern, and in it we caught rainwater for general household use. Across the meadow at the far left in the picture was a German family, which operated a small dairy. We hauled our milk supply from there. There was a garden behind our house, of course. We grew most of the vegetables we used. We got our meat down the road in the building you see at the right. It was operated, as I recall, by a family named Feinberg. Staple groceries were bought from the Z.A. Wilson General Store and Coal Yard at Elizabeth Avenue and Hammonds Ferry Road. Sometimes we carried groceries home by basket. For bigger loads, Robert Walters, who worked at the store, would deliver in a two-wheeled mule cart. In the right foreground of the picture, you can see a patch of woods. Deep in this, we found a fine variety of fruits: pears, apples, wax and black heart cherries, hickory nuts, and persimmons. The place may have been a farm many years earlier, but the woods had reclaimed it. There was also a beautiful collection of wildflowers: tremendous violets, lady slippers, trailing arbutus, laurel, and a carpet of crow's foot. Lansdowne was quiet and peaceful. In winter, the whole town turned out to skate on the ponds. In summer, there were church picnics, both at the church and in the woods. May 30th was always exciting, for then we celebrated Grand Army Day. A pastor at the Christian church had dedicated a memorial there to the Union Army, and in years to come, old soldiers, both Confederate and Union, came from all over the area on special B&O trains for our Grand Army Day program of picnicking, marching, and speech-making. Grand Army Day hasn't been observed now for many years. One old memory of Lansdowne doesn't show in the picture. That would be the many willow gardens, where residents grew willow switches for basket making. Like the old railroad station and the open, rolling pasture land around Lansdowne, the willows are long since gone.
And we thank you for putting up with us this afternoon. Ms. Rouse.
Let's give a big round of applause.
You heard it already. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, very welcome.